एटलीस्ट 25 ईयर्स यू नीड टू सर्व एज अ गवर्नमेंट एम्प्लॉयड, यू नीड टू गिव योर सर्विस, देन ओनली यू विल बी एबल टू गेट द मिनिमम 50% ऑफ देयर एवरेज सैलरी। Unified Pension Scheme. There is one article editorial in the Hindu newspaper which says it's a middle path. So it's between the NPS and OPS. In this, we the government employees will get the option to choose between the NPS or either UPS. It will start from the April 2025. We will discuss about the features. And another article in the Indian Express says the age guarantees a 50% of the salary as a pension. And it also says it's a fiscally and optically prudent. So basically, it will help in reducing the fiscal deficit burden. And how it will help beneficial to the employees and the government, we will see after seeing the features. So what are the details here? You need to understand it. Basically, government has approved the Unified Pension Scheme. And under this, it basically assures the 50% of the average salary drawn over the last 12 months of their service as a pension. So in whichever year they have served last, and the 12 month salary, 50% will be given as the pension. And you need to understand, under this, government has decided the contribution. For example, in the NPS new pension scheme, government was contributing around 14%. For the UPS, government has to contribute around the 18% of their salary, and employees' contribution will remain the same as earlier. It was 10% only. So features are, you need to understand, firstly I have tell you, at least 25 years you need to serve as a government employed, you need to give your service, then only you will be able to get the minimum 50% of their average salary. Even if you have served less than 25 years, then also you will get the pro rata basis pension. And in this, you need to understand, in the case the pensioner dies, even the family member will also get the 60% of the pension amount. These are the important features. And in the past, in the prelims exam, they have asked about the basically different pension scheme features. For example, Atal Pension Scheme, they have asked about it, and they have already asked about the NPS new pension scheme. So you need to understand its basic features. After that, even if the employee basically leaves the job after 10 years, then also he will get the pension of 10,000. After that, employees do not need to contribute separately as such. They need to contribute similarly like the NPS scheme. He was contributing 10%, but now the government will contribute 18%, and two separate funds will be created, in which 10% from contribution from the employer and the government will go into the one corpus, and the other 8% will go into the separate corpus. And the benefit of inflation will also be present, as in the basically NPS new pension scheme, no dearness allowance was given to the employees. That dearness allowance basically helps to curb the inflation effect, but in this, the inflation indexation will be done, so the employees will also get the dearness allowance after that. And on retirement, it is written that you will get the salary plus DNS allowance as the gratuity, apart from the gratuity. And on retirement, basically 10% of the monthly pay, including DA, for every 6 months, you will get also a additional lump sum amount. So you need to learn the basic features, that it will help in the inflation indexation. and your pension will be inflation indexed. So the effect of inflation will not be on the pensioner. Government will pay for that, and at least 50% will be given if the service is of 25 years. And if the pensioner dies, the family members will also get 60%. And if you are serving less than 10 years, then you will get the pension of at least 10,000. Now, you need to understand one more thing. It means it is basically ensuring the dignity and financial security of the employees. So basically, the resignation in the government service can be reduced with it, because government is guaranteeing their pension of about 50%. After that, it also says, Prime Minister has also said that it will be able to benefit around 23 lakh central employees and the 90 lakh central government employees. So it will benefit these number of employees. And the UPS, I have already told you, it's a middle ground between the NPS and OPS. We have taken the both of the features from them. For this, we have already told you 10% will be the contribution by the employees, and the government was earlier contributing 14%, but now it will contribute around 18%. Even as per RBI, it has estimated that the total pension burden on the exchequer, that is a state government, it's around 6 to 21% of the total revenue receipts. So whatever that revenue receipts coming to the different state governments, around 6 to basically 40 21% is going for the pension amount. So there is a burden on the pension on the government. And recently, in the last 1 year, there was a news, there was a debate whether the OPS need to be introduced rather the NPS or not. As the NPS was introduced to reduce the burden on the government, as the basically in the OPS only the government was in contributing, there was no contribution by the employees, but in the NPS there was a contribution introduced by the employer. 10% was basically contributed by the employees. But in the different states, it was doing that they were bringing back the OPS, that basically retweeted the debate whether the OPS was needed or the NPS. But the now government has brought UPS to find a middle ground between the OPS and NPS. It has taken the benefits from both of them. We need to discuss the about the basically the benefits and the difference between these. You need to understand, to reduce the pension burden, because I have already told you around 6 to 14, 21% of the revenue receipts is actually going for the pension. It means obviously government will take some steps to reduce its fiscal deficit. For this, they were hiring contractual employees. And as per data, around 47% of the government employees are contractual. What it will happen due to it? Obviously, those employees will not have the social security, and they will not have even employment security. In this kind of scenario, the basically craze for the government jobs will be reduced, and the people will not go for the public sector jobs. Thereafter, government is also resorting to the outsourcing. By outsourcing, obviously, it will reduce the burden of the pension. Thereafter, the schemes like Agni Path was also introduced by the government, where there was no guarantee of the pension, and even after 4 years, there was no guarantee of the employment. All these has been raising question on the employment. That is why we need to basically find other ways to reduce the pension burden rather than resorting to these kind of schemes or the factors. After this, let's discuss what is the difference between OPS and NPS and UPS. You need to first understand, old pension scheme, there was no contribution by the employee. So only the government was contributing. But in the NPS, we have introduced the contribution by the employee. Here, there was a guarantee of basically pension. 50% of the salary was actually given as a pension to the employee. But in NPS, no guarantee of the pension, because it was a market linked. it was dependent on the market returns. As the pension was invested in the market, thereafter whatever the return will come, that will be given to the employee. So there was no guarantee of the amount as such, but in the OPS there was a guarantee. That is why people were saying we want to OPS, but now in the UPS there will be a guarantee of 50% if you have served 25 years. Thereafter it was not a market linked, and in this the scheme includes a provision for the DNS allowance. So DNS allowance was also given in the OPS, but in NPS there was no DNS allowance. You need to understand here, there was a 10% contribution from the employees. I have already told you, as there was no contribution from the employee in the OPS, but now in the NPS there was contribution. Same contribution will be continuing in the UPS. Thereafter, I have already told you, its returns dependent on the market, and NPS does not offer the DNS allowance. As it does not offer the DNS allowance, it means it basically not prevent the inflation effect. So inflation indexation was not done in it. And thereafter it says, leaving the persons vulnerable to the inflation to receive a pension after the retirement. In fact, in the NPS one thing was also done. From the 100%, supposedly you are having the 1 lakh as a pension total amount, from this 40% will also again not given to you, it will be again invested in the market and you will get only 60% of your amount, and this is depending on the market returns. So 40% again was reinvested in the market and you will get only 60%. I hope you are able to understand from the OPS how the NPS was better, because it was a mark based on the market return. So investment was done, and in fact there was a contribution by the employee also. It has reduced the burden on the government. But in the OPS there was a guarantee of the pension, that is 50%. So the employees wanted that guarantee, and in fact they wanted the DNS allowance because it helps in basically reduces the vulnerability of the inflation. Now the conclusion is, I hope you are able to understand, OPS offers the stability and the government backed funding, but NPS was a market linked approach. That is why these both are needed. We need a market linked approach. So in the UPS we also invest that funds into the market, but we also provide the stability, and although the government backed funding will also be increased from the 14% to 18%. So it combined both best of the both of the worlds, while the offering assured benefits and inflation protection will also be there without placing the funding burden on the employees, as the employees will burden will contribute only 10% as it was there in the NPS. I hope you are able to understand. We have brought both of the features of the OPS and NPS in the UPS, and in the exam, prelims exam, you can get a question on the difference between these three, and maybe they can ask about the features of the UPS. In the mains examination, maybe if you are writing about the fiscal deficit problem or the fiscal federalism, there you can write about the pension schemes. For example, in the fiscal federalism, you can write between the state and central government there is a debate of which of the pension scheme needs to be introduced, and for the reducing the fiscal deficit, what kind of measures taken by the government. There you can mention about the unified pension scheme. I hope you are able to understand the features of the UPS and the difference between OPS, NPS and UPS, and you have also quote the point that how it can be asked in your exam. Oh,